watching at home. As you know, we have started this tradition on Communion Sunday of having a hymn sing. We've done it on telesong, we've done it kind of sparse. So the other weeks, the drums will be back. We're kicking it back. This is a beautiful day to celebrate the Lord. Turn with me in our continuing study of the Gospel of Luke to the second chapter of Luke. We are at verse 39, so at the end of the chapter 52. Speaking of Joseph and Mary and Jesus and the family, when they had performed everything according to the law of the Lord, they returned into Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. Now, his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of Passover. And when he was 12 years old, he went up according to custom. And when the feast was ended, as they were returning, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents did not know it, but supposing him to be in the group, they went a day's journey, and they began to search for him among their relatives and acquaintances. And when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem searching for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard them, all heard him, were amazed at his understanding and his answers. And when his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Sons, why have you treated us so? Behold, your father and I have been searching for you in great distress." And he said to them, "Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" And they did not understand the saying that he spoke to them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was submissive to them. And his mother treasured up all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in stature and in favor of God and man. Hebrews 4:12 reminds us that the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Let's pray. Almighty, eternal, merciful God, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our paths. Open and illuminate our hearts and minds that we may better understand your word and that we may conform our lives to what we've understood. In the great name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. We've got a question for the parents here. Have you ever lost a child? Some parents, maybe the question is, how many times did you displace a child? I remember as a little kid on vacation, searching the beach. somewhere where someone had seen her but didn't realize she was a Dorst, and said, "Oh, there's no Dorst in here." No Dorst is. Another time we were at a wedding, and it was the reception, and we were all kind of dancing and eating and enjoying ourselves, and at some point we kind of broke into, "Where's Wesley?" He was about 10 years old at the time, and so this was a hotel ballroom, and so we fanned out, and we stopped with the whole reception, and the DJ got on the mic, and Wesley Dorst, we were here, and nothing. When we were looking, and then, of course, we're thinking somebody grabbed him, somebody's driven away. A few minutes later, he kind of sheepishly comes out from under one of the tables where there was a long tablecloth. We couldn't see him. He thought we were going to make him dance. And so, as a 10-year-old, that was not going to happen. Thanks for letting me share that one. Thank God we found our kids and never actually lost children. I know we had a nightmare. I think of all the rest of the nightmares of my good sons. Today's passage is actually the only glimpse into Jesus' life in between when he was a small child and when he was about 30 years old. Right when he began his ministry. This is the only glimpse at teenage or preteen Jesus that we have. We don't have anything of his years in the carpenter shop. When we talk about Jesus' life and his humanity, and we talk about the fact that he experienced everything that we experience other than sin. And what we usually mean is that he was hungry and tired, that he experienced temptation. He had the full range of human emotion, grief, joy, all these things. But we see here one of those human experiences being lost by your parents. But of course, like both of my experiences that I told you about, he wasn't actually lost. Like my kids actually weren't lost. In fact, he was doing some important things. So let's look at verses, we're going to start at verse 41 through 46. We'll come back to those kind of introductory verses. And let's look at the time when Jesus was lost and found. So that's my first point. Jesus was lost and found. So he does again. Now, his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up according to custom. And when the feast was ended, as they were returning, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents did not know it, but supposing him to be in the group, they went a day's journey. But then they began to search for him among their relatives and acquaintances. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem searching for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them, and asking them questions. I would continue to get a glimpse into the piety and the observed, obedient religious observance of Joseph and Mary. Right? Just as they took Jesus to be circumcised and dedicated in the appropriate times in last week's passage. So this week we read that they went to Jerusalem to attend the Passover festival that they did every year. If you were within a certain distance of Jerusalem by law, you were expected to attend. Now, Passover was one of three annual festivals. The other two were the Feast of Tabernacles and Pentecost, the other two. This was somewhat, you can kind of read into the text, and it was kind of somewhat family reunion week, although maybe they mostly all lived near each other in their hometown. They traveled together. Maybe that was for safety. It's interesting, the population of Jerusalem would swell from around 25,000 to 30,000 to maybe up to 180,000 during that week when there was the pilgrimage and the festival. Now, Jesus' age of 12 is significant because at age 13, he would become a full member of the congregation, of the synagogue, similar to the modern celebration, the custom of bar mitzvah, so declaring a young boy a man. But I think actually I see more of our custom of community class, where kind of in that age range, somewhere in the 10 to 14 year age range, we offer classes and a chance for the children who have grown up in church to then profess their faith and become members of the church on their own. Right? So far they've been members under their parents, but then they're brought in on their own profession of faith. So I think that's a similar thing. So Jesus is a year away from that happening. And that's a time probably when most of the boys were trying to really figure everything out and make sure they would be able to answer whatever they needed to answer. We'll see in this passage that Jesus wants to be there, wants to be in the synagogue, right? Anywhere they were worshiping his Father, he wanted to be. Now, you may wonder how you lose a child, how you not get a head count before you head back home, how you get a whole day's journey. And maybe there was some protocol that they were used to Jesus following on these trips, and he was old enough, and he was hanging out with his cousins, and so maybe Joseph was in the front, thought he was with Mary, I'm not sure what happened, but it took a day's journey there, a day's journey back. I tend to think that you see these movies and TV shows where they talk about the first 72 hours is critical to finding a missing person and a lost child. After that, it said 3 days, so that would be the 72-hour, but I don't know if that includes the day out and day back, and 3 days searching in Jerusalem, or if it was just 3 days total. But can you imagine? I mean, we panicked when we were looking for our kids after like half an hour, probably after 10 minutes. Imagine searching for your kid for that many days. Thankfully, someone thought to look in the tent, and there he is. So the next 5 verses show us the nature of Jesus' dual sonship, as he has allegiance to both his earthly parents and his heavenly Father. So let's read about that in verses 47 to 51. Jesus is earthly parents and heavenly Father. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. And when his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us so? Behold, your father and I have been searching for you in great distress." And he said to them, "Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" And they did not understand the saying that he spoke to them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was submissive to them. And his mother treasured up all these things. Now, Jesus will spend a lot of time in his later ministry answering questions that were asked of him by doing what? By asking the question back. And he started that practice here. Mary says, "Why have you treated us so?" And Jesus responds with the question, "Why were you looking for me?" It's hard to get the tone of that, but it sounds like more of an accusation. How could you not think this is where I would be? "I must be here," he said. Not that I like to be here or I choose to be here. Jesus said, "I must be here. This is part of my calling." Now it's interesting, when I was taking Greek many years ago, by a Greek teacher assigned this very passage. Because he wanted to see how I would translate it. This was in the translation stage and figure out what to do about the question that the text raised. In the ESV, what Jesus says in the second part is, "Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" Right? And maybe some of you have other translations, I think it's the King James or the New King James, that says, "Did you not know that I must be about my father's business?" And so the the question is, which one do you go with, or what do you do here? And the question is not that there's a Greek noun that can be translated either one. The question is, there's no noun. So what do you do? Because literally what Jesus says is, I must be about the of my Father. There's nothing there. So I don't, maybe, you know, some people said maybe it was a scribe was there. Maybe Luke just forgot. It doesn't really make sense without a noun. But I think that there's what I came up with when I was going through this exercise with my Greek teacher, is that there are many things that Jesus could have been referring to. And there are a lot of things that Jesus could have put there. Thinking of the will of my Father, I must be about the Father's will, about the things of my Father, the work of my Father, certainly the house of my Father, works of the people of my Father. There are a lot of things that that could have been referring to. And what's really interesting is that these are the very first words we have from Jesus, right? Nothing is recorded. Obviously, when he's a little child, and anything else. These are his first words in any of the Gospels. And it's about obeying his Heavenly Father. And you see the end of his life, him saying essentially the same thing, not my will, but your will be done. Right? That his life begins and ends and is filled with obedience to his Father's will. Now, the Gospels record Jesus calling God Father over 60 times. No one in the Scriptures had ever called God my Father before. No one had dared to assume that exclusive intimacy. Jesus does. Jesus claims that. If we take nothing else from this passage, we should see that Jesus knew that he was God's Son. That God was his Father, even before he entered adulthood. We would call him teenager. They didn't really have that concept. You were an adult at 13. Here Jesus was. Now, his parents, right, the text says, they didn't understand what he was saying. But he went home with them. And then verse 51, it says that he was submissive to them. And so there's this tension that Jesus is submissive to his Heavenly Father and his earthly Father. Does this mean that Jesus sinned and was disobedient to the fifth commandment, that he didn't obey his father and mother? Some people have actually put that forward here. I think that really destroys the New Testament's insistence on Jesus' absolute sinlessness. I think a better, more helpful way to think about it. Think about some of Jesus' other teaching. We're going to study in Luke 14, 26. Jesus says some puzzling things. He says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate mother and father, wife, children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. So we're going to dig in when we get there. Is that really what we're supposed to do? I see a lot of loving families here. What does that mean to hate? Maybe the idea that our allegiance to God takes such first primary priority that everything else is hate and contrast, or that we consider our allegiance to God first, while we still obviously love those around us. We still honor our parents. I think it's even kind of the same kind of insistence that Jesus had when his disciples urged him not to go to jail, that he needed to go to be obedient to his father's will. All right, let's go back, pick up the first couple of verses and the last one, the bookends of the passage that show Jesus in favor with God and man. So verses 39, 40, and 52. And when they had performed everything according to the law of the Lord, they returned to the Galilee, in their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong. And the favor of God was upon him. And Jesus increased. God commands. The first day Jesus was attended at the wall that we did with a pencil every year, watching him grow. But I'm sure they were astonished to see him grow in other ways. Maybe comparing notes with other families. Does your kid know that already? He's pretty smart, okay? Parents do that. Jesus, in one sense, was like any other child who grew up and adjusted and figured things out at different ages. But he was unlike any other child. He did it without sinning, still retaining his divinity. And think of just how much more he engaged. How much did Jesus know about his unique mission and the role of God's plans for humanity and what age? It doesn't totally spell it out. We don't know exactly, but the language in verses 40 and 52 seem to indicate that Jesus grew in wisdom, understanding gradually, and that he had to study and ask questions just like anybody else. I know, no doubt there were things that puzzled him earlier in life that cleared up as he studied the scriptures, as he asked the teachers of the law, as he was doing when they found him, as the Holy Spirit revealed things to him. I think it's fascinating. You could even see maybe Jesus was ready for his public ministry at that younger age, since he was already astounding the religious leaders, astonishing his parents. But he waited for God's timing. He spent, really, somewhere around 18 more years studying, working with his dad, the carpenter shop, until he leaves and began his ministry, calling his disciples, healing and teaching. Now, I spent some time last week, a little application of how we should honor the contributions of our older folks, of our elderly, of those later in life. I want to remind us today of the importance of teaching and discipling our children and teens, and how that needs to be an important priority for our church, for our families. Right? We don't expect our kids to be wowing theologians like Jesus was at the age of 12, but we should not underestimate how much they can learn and understand. I mean, everybody knows it's easier to learn foreign language as a kid, right? Probably memorize scripture. Let's take advantage of some of the advantages of youth and teaching our kids. They need a serious grounding in the scripture. They need some basic theology so that when they leave our homes, when they go off, that they have that foundation that they can build upon. I've seen too many kids go off to college who didn't have enough of a foundation so that when people ask them hard questions, the faith somewhat collapsed. That people would bring objections to Christianity that apologists have been answering. There are many answers for these things, but they just hadn't studied them and didn't know them. Let's invest in our children and build them from an early age. Alright, how many of you have seen the new Pixar movie Soul? Disney Plus, anybody seen it? Alright, a couple. If you haven't seen it, it's one I kind of recommend. There's some really amazing messages. I was reading somebody that well, I won't go into that. Let me sketch out the plot a little bit. All right, I know I give away a lot of spoilers, so I'm not going to do that. You can pick up everything I'm about to say from the trailer if you want to see it. Essentially, the plot is that there is a jazz piano player named Joe Gardner who is very frustrated because he just hasn't been able to pursue his musical dream. He wants to play jazz for a living, but he's stuck as a middle school wasn't his vision for life. And I would actually really enjoy the movie just about that. But yeah, I'd be happy to see that. takes a turn, you see this in the trailer, and he gets pulled into the spiritual realm. Okay, and make a long story short, essentially, he finds himself in the place where pre-born souls are waiting to be born. Okay, and he kind of fakes his way to becoming a mentor for them. So the main premise is that each soul has to find their spark. Okay? This is what's going to be their life's work or their mission, or the thing that will bring them happiness and passion before they're actually allowed to be sent to earth to live. Alright? So I'm not going to tell you more than that kind of premise. Obviously, there's some serious poetic license that they've taken, that souls exist before they come to earth to be born. I'm not sure where they came up with that, but I think it's actually kind of an interesting look at nature versus nurture, and coming down firmly on that nature debate that kids are already kind of pre-wired to like certain things, and so it makes sense when they pursue something they love and know what they want to do with their lives. So that's, I was reminded of all that. As we're here in this scripture passage, we have this child who seems to be pre-wired to pursue one mission in life. Right? He's found his spark. It's part of, because it's part of who he is. His life will be lived in helping, loving, and leading others. But more importantly, it will be fulfilled in fulfilling his Father's will for him. More than any other human being who ever lived, Jesus was absolutely fixed in his mission, in his life's work. You know, he didn't get to the age of 30 and look around and go, maybe I can do something off here. You know, I figured out some things I can teach and figured out some ways to heal people and maybe I could gather a few people. It wasn't the sunrise, he was his whole life driving him. I must be about my Father's business, built-in, divine sense of God's will for his life throughout his life. Now, as part of all this, I want us to, let's not forget the setting of this whole passage. All right, why are they in Jerusalem? It's the Feast of Passover. And as we learned this past summer, as we worked our way through the book of Exodus, Passover was a yearly celebration of what God had accomplished back in Moses' day, right? The 10th plague of the Lord taking the life of the firstborn of the Egyptians, but passing over the Hebrews who painted blood on their door, partook in the Passover feast. All right, so Jesus' family was in Jerusalem to celebrate that feast. And so just picture on the actual day of Passover, around 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the lamb that the family had brought would have been slaughtered. All right? And then that night, Joseph, Jesus' father, would have taken his family through the Passover liturgy as the family ate the lamb that had been roasted. Right? We even know it as the Seder, which means order. There are blessings and prayers and songs and recounting of the 10 plagues that God sent to Egypt. If you've ever participated in one or heard about it, there are actually 4 cups of wine that are drunk throughout this liturgy. And they have names. The cup of remembrance, the cup of salvation, the cup of redemption, and the cup of nationhood. And then there's a 5th cup that is not drunk. It is the cup of ultimate redemption, also known as Elijah's cup. It was the cup that awaited the new Messiah. We know from the Gospels and later in Luke that Jesus would celebrate that Passover meal in a room with his disciples. Right? In Luke 22, verse 15, he says, taking his children, disciples, through the Passover liturgy. But what his disciples would experience that day was the beginning of something new. Right? Jesus took that opportunity to expand the Passover liturgy that had been the same for 1,400 and some years. You know, that he had been celebrating his whole life, and then Israelites had been celebrating all those centuries. And he started talking about himself and placing himself in the liturgy about how his own body would be broken for them and how his blood would be poured out for them. This meal that had been centered around a lamb with no defects, that he would have been slaughtered in a symbolic way to have God's wrath pass over them, and then eaten, was suddenly given a new focus. Because there was a new Lamb of God without defect who would be slaughtered on their behalf. But this time it wasn't an animal, it was a person. Right? Jesus had been telling his disciples that he was headed to his death. And now he tells them that his death is a new covenant, a new agreement between God and man. So just like the lamb in the old Passover, the old covenant, Jesus the Lamb would be slaughtered in order for God's wrath to pass over his people. And the meal where they ate and drank in remembrance of his sacrifice on the cross would be called communion, the Lord's table, the Lord's supper. And how beautiful that we are headed there today to celebrate. When Jesus died on the cross, what hour of the day was it? Do you remember that? It was 3 p.m., the time when the lambs were sacrificed, slaughtered for Passover. And in a striking parallel to today's story, after Jesus died on the cross, was placed in a tomb, the parallel to he was lost to the world for 3 days. And on the third day, he was found and brought back to life, because he was going about his Father's business. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for this passage. I thank you that it gives us a glimpse into Jesus' life that we can only imagine what a sinless child would look like. Thank you that even as he grew in his wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, that he understood that he was on the mission that you had given, that he was to be about his Father's will, and that he was in the temple to worship himself as a ransom for many. Lord, as we reflect what he would have seen that week, as lambs being slaughtered and eaten, to save the people, as you invite us to your table this morning, because Jesus became your lamb, your sacrificial lamb who died once and for all, for the sins of every people, to appease the wrath that is due for our sin. And so we celebrate together.